Alrighty, welcome to a cube draft, a vintage cube draft even, here on channelfireball.com. As always, thanks to Ultimate Guard for being the sponsor of Team CFB and helping me get this soul ring here. We're going to slam soul ring. It's, you know, by some people's estimation, the best card in the cube. I personally think Time Walk is better, but I think Soul Ring, Lotus, and Time Walk, all comparable. So we're going to take Soul Ring over Skull Clamp, Shallow Grave. Not cards I'm particularly worried about. And we're going to follow it up with, something a little worse. But I actually think Fury is the pick here. If you really felt strongly that you wanted to draft like a green ramp deck and wanted to take Cobra, or White Weenie wanted to take like Esper Sentinel or Containment Priest, you could. I don't think that'd be right, though. I actually think Fury is just the best card in this pack by so much. I do love me a Lotus Field and a Crucible in the right decks. Sometimes the same one. But this cube's got, you know, a lot of creatures and planeswalkers. Those are the best threats still. And Fury just dunks on the aggro decks while being just a pretty hard-hitting creature. So, and free spells are good. So I'm going to take Fury here. And probably follow it up with a nice little Wooded Foothills. A red fetch is not bad. Hey, look, we could be red-green beats. That's actually a legit deck in the cube. And Sol Ring is actually at its best in a deck like that. That's just got a lot of assertive plays. Think cards like Questing Beast, Minsk and Boo, that sort of thing. Wooded Foothills, great fixer. I really want to play Fury, so a red fetch makes me more likely to do that. The next best card is probably a Braid, but I think Wooded Foothills is enough better. The fetch lands are really powerful. Then I would just take the Wooded Foothills and move on here. So we still don't really have a strong direction. Don't have to be green by any stretch. And of course, we might not even end up red. This is booster draft, right? You don't know what you're going to get past. I could get past a bunch of great blue and black cards and end up moving away from Fury entirely. But I think the most likely outcome here is that I'm either red, blue, or red, green, potentially red, black. Not super likely to be red, white, because the red, white decks tend to be base white. Fury's not that good in them, and Soul Ring's not that good in them. I mean, Soul Ring's still obviously good, but if I were to think of a deck that could harness Soul Ring, it's like an Academy deck, like a red-green beatdown deck, that sort of thing. Not so much a red-white deck. Yeah, no real reason not to take Bonecrusher Giant here. It's a strong card, and it's a red card, which is nice. It fits in the kind of aggressive vibe of Fury. Maybe we'll wheel Inti. Inti, Seneschal of the Sun, is actually a card that's really impressed me. 2-mana 2-2, but whenever you attack, you can discard a card to give an attacking creature a +1/+1 counter and trample. And then, whenever you discard one or more cards, exile your top card, you can play it this turn, which means if you discard to, like, Faithless Looting or something, this ability triggers as well, so which is pretty cool. I'm going to take Bonecrusher. I like Fatal Push a lot, too, but there's really no reason to take anything but a red card here when we're starting with Fury, Wooded Foothills, Soul Ring. Also, coincidentally, both of these cards, Bonecrusher and Fury, are quite good with Soul Ring, so not a high bar to clear, but, you know, I've had decks where Soul Ring's not that good. Like, you play a mono black reanimator deck and you open Soul Ring in pack three, you're still going to take it. It's just not going to be as good. Oh, we're going beats. Look at this. Glory Bringer. This is a card that's good with Soul Ring. You play this, you kill their creature, you hit them for four, maybe even kill a planeswalker and a creature if you're lucky. It's a great card. It's one of the best cards in the pack. The only cards that are comparable are some combo decks can really use Tamiya well, and Winter Orb can be really solid, but this is an easy Glory Bringer. Red seems open. Don't really see a reason not to just take these good red cards here. It's the sort of thing where, obviously I took Soul Ring, right? And then Fury was by far the best card in the pack. That one wasn't close. And then I took Wooded Foothills, and because I had those, now when I see Bonecrusher and Glory Bringer, that's a good tiebreaker, even if there are other good red cards or non-red cards in the pack. So here, there's Raugrin Triumph, red-green, red-blue-white, which makes Wooded Foothills pretty potent. But that might just take Mogda. Mogda's a 2-mana 2-1. When it becomes tapped, you get a treasure, and technically you can sack 5 treasures to go get this Glory Bringer. But mostly it's a 2-mana 2-1 that if they don't answer it, gets you pretty good advantage every turn. Also, it highlights how ridiculous Raghavan is, which Raghavan costs half as much and does more. I'm still probably just going to take Mogda. P and Kiran Nalar I found to be pretty replaceable. If I knew more about where this draft is going, I could see taking Raugrin Triumph, but I just don't see a reason to select a second color, though. Now I kind of have one, because Memory Lapse is so much better than the rest of the pack. counter target spell, and if the spell's countered that way, it goes on top of their deck. This is just such an effective counter. I like Samwise the Stouthearted too. You can evoke Fury, then Samwise get the Fury back. But I think Memory Lapse is perfect with all these cards, so I'll take it. Faithless Looting doesn't really fit with these red cards, so even though it's a red card, it's not one I'm that interested in playing. All right, so this is tricky, because on the one hand, Charming Scoundrel is a perfectly fine mono red card. 2 mana, 1/1 haste, and it's flexible. You either get to discard a card and draw a card, get a treasure, or put a Wicked Roll in one of your creatures. On the other hand, there's Fire Covenant, the weird Strixhaven version here, and this card is pretty busted. I think I'm just going to take Fire Covenant. Maybe I don't play Memory Lapse. Maybe I play both Fire Covenant and Memory Lapse. Who knows? I just think Fire Covenant is too good. Basically, 3 mana, kill all their creatures. Whoa, Chandra came around? Yeah, we're going to take Chandra. Look, Breeding Pool does make Wooded Foothills into blue for Memory Lapse, and that's all well and good. Red and Six, also a solid card, but Chandra is incredibly good just in general. It's kind of the red Jace the Mind Sculptor. But also with Sol Ring, turn 2 Chandra's no joke. So we've got the start to a great red mid-range deck. Could be aggressive. We haven't taken any of the really aggressive cards besides like Magda. But, you know, if we picked up Monastery Swift Spear, Fire Blast, Chain Lightning, that sort of thing, we could go more aggressive. Or a couple more blue cards, we could be blue-red tempo, or we could be black-red mid-range. Who knows? Yeah, here I probably just take Char. Red-black Talisman could help cast Fire Covenant. But Char's pretty good. I just don't feel like I'm strongly going in any direction here that isn't red. Like, I have one blue card and one black card. I guess I'll take a Sakura Tribe Elder, though I don't really see myself playing any of these cards. Ooh, Inti came back around. I like Inti more than Sulfuric Vortex here. Vortex is a good card if you're aggressive. Inti's good if you're aggressive or if you're mid-range. I don't know which direction I'm going. And this deck has a pretty high curve, so let's just take the Inti and go from there. So, still have to kind of decide which, if any, of these off-color cards we're going to play. But even if you look at just the mono-red cards, we have 8 cards already, plus a Wooded Foothills. It's a fantastic start. I mean, red seems open, and if a color's open, it's... I mean, this is, cube, you do a little bit less reading of signals because it's a little harder to. There's a lot of different things going on. But if a color's open, a color's open. I'm going to take Voldaren Thrillseeker here. This one I haven't been super impressed with. Guess I'll take Archangel Elspeth that I'm not going to play. There's no way I play Rafelos. Oh, Elvish Mystic. Okay. I guess I have Elvish Mystic and Sakura Tribe Elder, so who knows. All right, what do we got here? Well, this is tough because the best card in the pack's Oko. I don't really want a double splash. Grief is also a good card, but not clearly not for me. There's Sacred Foundry, which is actually pretty great with Wooded Foothills to enable a white splash. But I don't have any white cards. In fact, I have a blue card and a black card. So looking at the red cards, Flame Tongue's pretty good. Arc Trail is okay. It feels kind of bad to take a card like Flame Tongue over a much stronger card like Oko or Grief. But I think I should just take the red card. It's not, these off-color cards are not even of colors that I'm really that deep into considering. Like, this isn't even like a black card. I guess Grief is a black card, but not a splashable one or a blue card. There's also Reprieve, which is a great card, but I'm just going to take Flame Tongue Kavu here. Kind of defer the decision a little while. Solitude's also a fantastic card. What I could do here is I could take either Misty Rainforest or Ketria Triome, and then that enables Memory Lapse. Maybe I just take the Triome. I just don't think, like, I'm not going to take Grim Lavamancer or Bonfire here. That's just way too weak. Maybe I just take Misty, because if I find a blue-green land, which I already know one is gone, Breeding Pool's gone. Misty could be. No, let's just take Ketria Triumph. That's going to be safer. Pass up on Solitude, and yeah, it just didn't seem like white was all that open in pack one, so I'm going to take the Fire Covenant out here for the moment. If things change, I could bring it back. But I also think red-blue naturally is a really good pairing. And it also keeps you open to, you know, if you open any of the really busted blue cards in the third pack, you get to play those. So I think taking Ketria Triumph there is fine. It's good to have a second color here in the sense that there will be packs without red. Like, look at my opening pack. I don't dream of first picking Flame Tongue. So I'd rather have a card that's a second color that I can pick from in those cases. There's the Trop. I guess Misty would have worked out. I'm probably going to take Seasoned Pyromancer. I do like Mystic Confluence and Lorien Revealed and all that, but I still don't even know if I'm going to splash Pyromancer's Great, Oliphant, hopefully Wheels, but let's just take the Seasoned Pyro. I'm not sure about this Voldaren Thrill Seeker. I guess it's a pretty big burn spell. It's kind of nice with Flame Tongue. Flame Tongue has got a lot of power here. So we're like red mid-range, maybe splashing Memory Lapse, maybe not. I guess Ketria Triumph would have also let me splash Oko, kind of, but I really didn't want a double splash here. I just didn't seem like a very good idea. There's also Elvish Mystic and Sakura Tribe Elder, but now, oh, look at this. Perfect. We just take Remand. Remand is exactly what you want when you have these other cards. Seasoned Engineer is also a busted card. No one seems to be taking this card very highly, at least in the drafts I've been in, but they will learn eventually. All right, so Remand and Lapse, and now we could take Bloodthirsty Adversary. I actually like this card quite a bit. 2-mana 2-2, haste, but you can pay 3 to put a +1/+1 counter on it and replay a spell from your graveyard. You can do that actually multiple times. The problem is I only have one spell I can play. Granted, I probably will pick up more. I could also take Questing Druid. Questing Druid seems like it's playable here. Or Waterlogged Grove. Or I could take Metamorph. Metamorph's nice with Pyromancer, Flame Tongue, Fury, Glorybringer. Eh, that's kind of a lot of Metamorph things, and maybe Bloodthirsty Adversary Wheels. These packs, or this pack is not very good. I don't think I want Pentad Prism, but I could see Talisman of Impulse. There is a chance that I end up wanting to splash green as well. So I'll take the Talisman. I've got a bunch of fours and fives. I could see Talisman being good. And I kind of have free green mana at this point. I have Wooded Foothills, Ketria Triumph, Talisman. Not quite enough that I want Elvish Mystic and Sakura Tribe Elder in, but I'm thinking about it. Ketria Triumph is actually kind of convenient if I wanted to be red-green splash of these counters. Like, yeah, actually, let's consider it. Oh, man, I love Underworld Breach. Unfortunately, this is not the deck to take Breach in. There's Phantasmal Image, but I just took a clone. I don't really want a bunch of clones. I don't really want Rabbit Battery either. I could take Scrapwork Mutt. The card is fine. It's not great. It does kind of mini combo with Inti where you discard a card and get to exile your top card. I'm just going to take the Breach. I don't care. I might not even run it, but we haven't seen Brain Freeze yet. And like just putting Breach and Brain Freeze in your deck can be kind of nice. I just don't think I'm going to miss any of the other cards in that pack. I would hope not to play Scrapwork Mutt in like a non-reanimator deck or non-academy deck. So I'll take Underworld Breach just to keep my streak of never passing Underworld Breach alive. Let's put Elvish Mystic and Sakura Tribe Elder in here just for the time being. I don't think it's crazy to consider these. It's actually funny we've actually gotten to a place where I could put Oko in my deck. See, now there's Sylvan Caryatid and Chromehost Seed Shark, I guess. I think I'm actually just going to take Wasteland. Wasteland is great when you're doing these things. Red and Six is already gone, but I think Wasteland is just... There was also a Fiery Islet, but Wasteland is great in an aggressive deck, and honestly, I don't think I want to play these green cards. I just shouldn't have to. I feel like with Sol Ring and Talisman, I have some ramp, some acceleration here, and I already have 15 playables, which means I only need 7 or 8 cards from the next pack, plus the rest of this pack, which isn't even over. I mean, I guess we've seen every pack in this pack, but some cards should wheel, like Arc Trail has a decent chance of wheeling in this particular pick coming up. Let's just put the Chandra over here. Could use a little more burn. I would like to see Lightning Bolt, Chain Lightning, Fire Blast even I would play. That sort of thing would be nice. I wouldn't mind getting the Voldaren Thrill Seeker out of here. Okay, interesting. So the Arc Trail didn't wheel. That's not like a huge shock or anything. I could take Sacred Foundry or Jetmir's Garden here, though I guess I'd rather take Sacred Foundry between the two, or I could take Asika's Chariot. Chariot is a pretty nice one. Let's just take the Chariot. I don't think I'm going to play white. And I guess I could take Anduril here. I don't want to play Recruiter. Walroots just seems really bad. Anduril's more of a sideboard card. Chariot is a strong card. Make some giant cats here. I mean, I would have, currently, if I put a forest in, I'd have 4 green sources. I'm going to keep it in the sideboard still. We'll see. Maybe it'll make it in, but I still kind of hope not. Oh, Olifon Wield. That is great because that's perfect. It's a blue land when it gets Ketria Triumph, though it is double tapped at that point, and you can just cast it, and it can be very strong. So nice Olifant pickup, and I guess a blue-red Talisman seems like it's also a potential playable. It's better than red-green Talisman. Oh, Questing Druid came back? All right, now I'll take the Questing Druid. I actually kind of like where this is going because I can play this for the red half pretty easily, then later play the green half. And Pentad Prism. That's a late Pentad Prism and a late Restless Bivouac. All right. So let's see how pack three goes. Remember, I do have this Underworld Breach chilling here. All right, here we've got Channel and Natural Order and Force of Will. Don't really think I can play those. There's Arid Mesa, but honestly, I'd rather just take Smuggler's Copter. Copter is awesome. I've got a lot of creatures here. It's also a super combo with Mogda, because Mogda says when a dwarf becomes tapped, so you can crew the Copter with Mogda and immediately start making treasures. Goblin Guide, if it wheels, I might make it into the deck too. And Arid Mesa, I don't believe is going to wheel. Neither will Force of Will, but I'll take Smuggler's Copter. It's a fine pickup. And Entomb and Mana Drain. Wow, Mana Drain's a really good card. Grim Monolith doesn't seem that impressive here. I mean, I like Reckless Stormseeker. I really don't want a second pick it. So, can my mana support Mana Drain? I think it might be able to. With Wooded Foothills, Ketria Triumph, a couple islands, Olifant, Talisman, maybe Pentad Prism. The other option is to take Pest Infestation. This card's pretty splashable, and I've got that Triumph and the Foothills, and I have the red-green Talisman over here if I want it. So I think I'd still rather just take Mana Drain. I think, and then bias towards blue mana here if I can. Yeah, so this is interesting. I've got this Questing Druid just kind of hanging out. Pentad Prism almost assuredly makes it now that I've got Mana Drain. That's a good way to get to cast Mana Drain. Yeah, I mean, this is just like a blue-red tempo deck, and there's Comet. If I had taken that Sacred Foundry, I probably would take Comet here. Restless Bivouac's not going to do it. There's Miscalculation, which is great. Chandra, which is good. Jace, which actually doesn't look great here. Venser. Yeah, just take Miscalculation. Miscalculation looks pretty good in this deck, too. Could use a few more cheap plays here. Really, what I want is like a Lightning Bolt. It doesn't seem that hard to pick that up, but we'll see. We've got plenty of playables here. I'm not worried about that. All right, now there's Fire Ice, Dak Faden, Goldspan Dragon. Snapcaster I don't like. It's too blue intensive. I do love a Goldspan Dragon. Goldspan Dragon with Memory Lapse, Mana Drain, Miscalculation, Remand is pretty sick. Maybe I just do that. I just Turbo out a dragon with a Talisman or a Soul Ring or a Pentad Prism attack and have a counter up immediately. Plus, between Dak, Fire Ice, Rampaging Raptor, seems reasonable that one of those might wheel. So we're at 18 net land right now if we go up to 40. 19 with Olifant. So just looking for another card or two here. And we're only four picks into this pack. So four new packs, any of which could contain Lightning Bolt. Though, I guess the Grim Lavamancer didn't wheel. I'm just realizing now in pack two, so something to keep in mind. All right, well, the One Ring's a powerful card, but this is just a Steam Vents deck through and through. Steam Vents makes it so Olifant can get untapped blue, Wooded Foothills can get untapped blue, and just adds another blue-red duel. I don't really need another 4-mana powerful play. I have Chandra, I have a bunch of dragons. Steam Vents looks perfect. Late Shieldred, too. And now there's Jace versus Polluted Delta. Polluted Delta looks great for me. I think I'll just take that. As much as I like Jace, I, again, erring on the side of just having good mana, because I really want this Mana Drain to work. And now that I have all this, I could also pretty easily play Asika's Chariot, I think, because I'm going to have Polluted Delta, which can get Ketria Triumph, Wooded Foothills, Ketria Triumph, so that's three. Plus Prism, Olifant, a lot of stuff. All right, so here we've got Forked Bolt, which is the cheap removal spell I was looking for. Mind Collapse, which also does work. Thundermaw Hellkite, but I don't think I need that. And Thieving Skydiver, which is a fantastic card. I think this deck just wants the Forked Bolt here. I just want some cheap interaction. Feels like this deck could use a little bit of that, because it's got all these counters up too. So if you can just kill the first thing they play and counter the second thing, that's pretty nice. So this is 17 land right now. So this is me not having to cut anything. And we pick up a Teferi I can't play. A Hellrider I'm not like the most excited to play, but maybe I will. I'm not going to play Zerda, though whoever takes the Grim Monolith might take it. Let's just take the Hellrider and probably not play it. So Phyrexian Dragon, Engine Wield, sort of Delighted Halfling, Blood Crypt. You know, if I took Blood Crypt, this deck could play Fire Covenant kind of for free. I think that sounds great. We're not a natural order deck, that's for sure. Scrubland doesn't do anything for me. Sir Ginger is a fine card, though. If they have a Planeswalker, I can randomly just bash them. So now we're at 15 lands, so we just added a couple cards. I think Ovaldar and Thrillseeker can probably go. I'm not playing any of these cards, probably. And I do need to get the Fire Covenant in there if I want that. Oh, Rampaging Raptor came back. All right, nice. I can probably just cut the Asika's Chariot at this point because I don't want to play a basic forest in my deck. Oh, well, Taiga's free and makes this Questing Druid a lot better. I wonder if it makes Asika's Chariot worth playing. Also, I just have five free green sources or something. I can probably get rid of Talisman of Creativity or Pentad, one of those two at this point as well, it feels like. I mean, let's go to deck building, but I like where we ended up. The only thing is I really would have liked another cheap burn spell. I mean, Forkbolt was one, but it felt like red was really open in pack one and a lot less open in packs two and three. I think Hellrider I will try to cut. Yeah, I mean, this is 17 lands now. 16 plus an Oliphant. Don't really have too much of a complaint here. I guess maybe I don't need both Talisman and Pentad Prism. Honestly, my mana's gotten good enough that... I was going to say I could ditch Pentad Prism, but turn three Goldspan is pretty appealing. So I've got Voldaren Thrillseeker, Hellrider, maybe Asika's Chariot as potential cards. Oh, and Fire Covenant if I want to play that. Yeah, I think I do like Fire Covenant. Because if I just play this Blood Crypt, I'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 black sources, and I think I'll cut the Talisman. And currently, I mean, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 blue sources plus Pentad Prism already. So which means the 9 lands I get to add, if I add like 2 and 7, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, I can actually go one less red, go 3 and 6, play no green or no red. I just ended up taking lands pretty highly here. Shocker, I've never done that before. And I think that looks good. I guess I do like Pentad Prism less than Talisman when you go land Sol Ring and you can't play Prism there because it wouldn't have Sunburst. But given that I have a black card and a green card in my deck, it kind of feels nice to have Pentad Prism as backup there. Is there any chance I want to play one fewer land? Actually, hold on. I think I will. Right now I have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, I'll take a mountain out because I think I have tons of red still. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 plus the Oliphant 13. Yeah. Let's take out one land. And can I play this as Sika's Chariot? Or should I just play Hellrider or Voldaren Thrillseeker? How many green do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4. I mean, I'll have like 5 green sources. Plus Mogda does make treasures as well. Hellrider doesn't seem amazing here. I'm just not going to have that many creatures in play. Maybe I just play the Voldaren Thrillseeker. All right, I'll try that. I just want one more spell in my deck. I feel like Sol Ring plus Oliphant plus 15 lands should be plenty, especially with Pentad Prism as well. And I don't want to end up in a spot where like I can't crew Smuggler's Copter, for example. So I'm going to try the Voldaren Thrillseeker. Yeah, I don't think I want Hellrider instead. Asika's Chariot is a little more appealing as well, but just feels like, I guess I have Glorybringer and Mogda making treasures too. All right, I changed my mind once more. We're going to get this Asika's Chariot in here and take the Voldaren Thrillseeker out, and we don't need to play a basic forest at all. We already have a Wooded Foothills, or a Taiga to get with the Wooded Foothills, so I'm not concerned about that. It's going to be nice when I go into your Magda into, like, Mana Drain. It's just pairings of cards that don't usually happen. Mana Drain into, like, a Glorybringer is pretty sick, though. I mean, if I'm entered in something big, I could go, like, Goldspan, Metamorph the Goldspan, attack for 8, make 2 treasures. That sounds pretty great to me. So, let's see what our first opponent has to say to us. So what could we have done differently with this pool? I don't think there was much of a, or not pool, but like the whole draft. I don't think there was a very clear way to not be in red. I just think that Fury is that good. And the biggest difference is I could have had any secondary color, honestly. All of the other 4 colors could have been my second color. All right, I'm on the play. I will keep this hand. I get to go Taiga go, and then I get to play turn 2 Magda. And if they don't have a kill spell or a counter spell for Magda, I can run away with the game. Especially since I have a Fury, I can just pitch Chandra to Fury, kill a blocker. And then if Magda gets one good attack in and I have miscalculation up, that is a huge game. Okay, basic island go. So this is looking pretty good. I'll play the mountains. They don't know about the wasteland. All right, no Stern Scolding, please. No. Okay, let's consider. That is not too bad. Not too bad at all. Okay, so they just considered and kept the card, which probably means they have an answer to Magda, but doesn't necessarily. Maybe they kept a one-lander. Well, red makes it a lot more likely, yeah. And it's basic, so I can't even wasteland them, though I kind of don't want to wasteland. I want to hit my fourth land drop. I'm just going to play Sir Ginger here. I guess I could have maybe cycled miscalculation. Well, that could have been better. This is such a bigger reward, though, if it works. Like, if I just draw a land next turn, getting to hit for 3 is a pretty awesome upside. Oh, man. Okay. Seasoned Pyro dunks on Sir Ginger pretty hard. But if I draw a land here, I'm just going to go Rampaging Raptor, Fury all your tokens, and then bash you through the Breach. Yeah, their deck looks pretty good. Force Negation through the Breach, Lightning Bolt, consider Seasoned Pyro is not bad. All right. Land? How could this happen to me? I will cycle Miscalculation, I guess. I'm still going to... Okay, now I play the Ketria Triumph. I'm going to cast Fury. I'm going to exile the Fire Covenant at this point. Got to be good for something. And then go... Okay. And... Look, it's not that bad. It's just if I was hitting them with the Rampaging Raptor at the same time, I feel like I would be crushing this game. As is, it's close. We'll see what they do on their turn. But basically my turn 4, Fury kind of made up for it, but I did waste my turn 4. Oh, geez. Their deck looks great. Black Lotus, huh? All right. Hopefully they Lotus something out, something that I can deal with using Chandra. But I can't say I'm optimistic about this. Oh, Time Twister. That could have been a lot worse. I mean, they had 3 cards in their hand. They didn't play. Their Lotus is gone. Obviously, they can replay Lotus. I'm just waiting for that. But they've already played their land. If they just play a 4-drop, especially if I'm actually still in a position where I really want to draw a land, funnily enough. I guess if I don't draw a land, I want to have Remand up next turn. So I really do want to draw a land here. So I could Seek the Beast. If I miss on lands, it's really bad, but my hand is so thick. I need to find some mana here. Otherwise, I'm going to be really heavily restricted on how I can play my spells. My plan here, okay, I hit Goldspan and Wooded Foothills. Yeah, that is totally fine. I'm going to Wasteland your Underground Sea. And now I have to decide, I'm going to attack first, but do I play Smuggler's Copter or do I leave up Remand? I kind of think I just play Smuggler's Copter. Oh yeah, now I definitely do. Well, I don't have anything to crew it with. I could potentially have the questing druid. I guess I could also play the questing druid. 19. Get steam vents. Actually, yeah, why don't I just play questing druid actually? Because this is going to grow fairly quickly. It also doesn't require me to have anything to crew up. I do need to draw a land in order to play Goldspan, but I think it was worth wastelanding them. Because I don't want them to have that big of a play, and it cuts them off of a color. Also, if I don't end up playing the Goldspan, my hand is just completely filled with action. So that's not going to be a limiting factor here. All right, land would be nice. Okay, now what? I think I'm going to start by playing Inti here. I don't think playing one spell into a counterspell really makes sense. So I'm going to attack. Oh, actually, Inti is actually pretty sick. Because now if the questing druid gets to attack, I get to discard a card and I could maybe play something. Oh, Inti triggering right away is awesome. What do I want to discard? I kind of want to discard Asika's Chariot. Because Raptor's a better 4-drop. Metamorph's nice if they do something like put an Archon of Cruelty into play. You might be able to free roll them. And I'm not going to discard Remand. So that leaves Chariot, Copter, Bonecrusher, Char, and I think I'm just going to discard my most expensive card. All right. Can I hit a land here? No, but a Pentad Prism, that's interesting. I think I play it. So here's the advantage. If I play Pentad Prism now, if I don't have to use the mana, great, I have extra mana next turn. And if I do, it's like leaving Remand up. So it's kind of like leaving Remand up where it's break even if you have to Remand and you're ahead if you don't. Whereas not playing the Prism, it's break even if you have to Remand, but if they don't play anything, you're behind. You wasted two mana. So this is a kind of nice hedge. Had I not hit anything else, I probably would have had to play Copter, though. Maybe with two creatures in play, I wouldn't have needed to. I'm not remanding a one drop. Dragon's Rage Channeler is just not that scary right here. It's nice that instant is already one of the card types here because if they play an instant, they still have to hit like creature, artifact, enchantment, planeswalker, which is not the easiest thing in the world. They already have sorcery. Yeah, they have instant sorcery land. So creature is the main thing they could hit, though I guess in their deck, artifact is also a possibility. Magic Online, everyone's been cubing so much, there's a little bit of a delay. All right, Demonic Tutor, sure. So I'm glad I wastelanded them because they might not have been on black mana for a while. I would like to draw a counterspell here because I kind of feel like I'm going to be forced to use this Remand soon. And so drawing a Mana Drainer Memory Lapse would go a long way. Yeah, their Dragon's Rage Channeler is not big yet, which is nice. Mm-hmm. Oh, Ancestral Recall. Jeez, they have Lotus and Ancestral? Okay, this is not going to be... And Demonic Tutor. Their deck looks great. All right, I'm not going to remand that. It doesn't really help. Okay, hopefully they don't have anything too great to play. Not having to use my Remand is not bad. All right, let's draw land. I think I just play the Rampaging Raptor here. Oh, they're at 14. No, actually, maybe I go attack with Inti. I guess I already played my land, but attack with both. No, I can just have Remand up still. Let's just cast the Raptor. Because I also get a counter on the Questing Druid, which is really nice. And they haven't been doing anything, so putting the fastest clock on them seems ideal. They have fire ice. I guess we'll see. All right, let's attack with these three, and I will discard a card. Here, I think I discard Smuggler's Copter. The game has just progressed past that point. I'm going to put a counter on Inti. That way, if... I hit Memory Lapse. Nice. That means they just get free rolled if they play anything. So actually, if they take it all, I could just char them to death. I mean, I don't have to do it right away, but it's something that I could run. All right, they're blocking that. It doesn't have trample, so just pass. And then Petty Theft of the Rampaging Raptor. I'll let them surveil. So as things stand, they take three. Oh, I should just memory lapse that. Because it's just so free. I wouldn't get to cast the memory lapse anyway. They end up taking seven down to seven, which means, and then they're drawing the Brazen Borrower again. Look, there's a chance I do just lose right now, but it's not like Remand is the hardest of counters. It's very easy to imagine. Like if they set up Underworld Breach, Brain Freeze, Remand doesn't really stop that. Like they cast Breach, I Remand it, they just recast Breach, it costs two mana. So I kind of feel like putting myself in a position to win the fair game, which I just did, is better than trying to play around them having like a combo. Because it'd be like trying to play around them having like a bad combo, because a good combo still beats you. I don't want to put myself in a position where I beat a bad combo, lose to a good combo, and lose to a fair game where they just play two good removal spells. So I like that. I do think I want Hellrider though, and I don't particularly want Fire Covenant. I can also take out the Blood Crypt at that point. Another mountain. Voldoran Thrillseeker is interesting. Flame Tongue Kavu also seems kind of bad. All right. I'll keep the Fork Bolt there. That one's cheap enough. Had I gotten Chain Lightning, I would also consider Underworld Breach just as a card to play. Like Underworld Breach, Chain Lightning is kind of a nice combo, especially with some fetch lands to fill the graveyard. But Fork Bolt, not quite going to do it. So we still don't really know what their deck is besides all like kind of broken cards, right? They have like Ancestral, Black Lotus, Demonic Tutor, but Time Twister, but they cast all those cards and then cast like a Seasoned Pyromancer and a Dragon's Rage Channeler, a Petty Theft, like a Brazen Borrower. So it looks like they're like Grixis Control, but they have Time Twister, and I could easily believe that they have a combo finish somewhere in there. So clearly I don't like the matchup in terms of card quality. They've got my Soul Ring outnumbered badly. But it feels like my deck has a focused plan. It's just red aggressive creatures with a bunch of blue counterspells. And that's pretty good against control. Like one of your good matchups is something like Grixis Control. So, and combo. This deck also tends to prey on combo. Yeah, I'll keep this. Once again, I'm going to go for Magda and see if I can just get that train rolling. My opponent did mulligan here. Okay. But they have, Restless Spider. Sure. All right. Pentide Prism going to help me cast some Remands and Memory Lapses. And probably have no plays here. All right, I'm going to cast Magda. If it works out, then great. Okay, it has resolved, though we didn't see much in the way of counters. Yeah, and it got bolted again. That's fine. We're still going to play Voldoran Thrillseeker next turn. And then maybe Hellrider the turn after. That seems acceptable. All right, Island isn't bad, but I still have to get Thrillseeker onto the battlefield. I just don't think it really makes sense for this deck to play Pentide Prism and leave up a counter. The other thing, Memory Lapse and Remand are great cards. They are what you call soft counters. You know, they don't fully counter something. And on an early game, empty board, if I lapse or Remand, like a Planeswalker, they just play it again. Oh, they had Prismari Command. At least they're doing draw two, discard two, because that means their hand is kind of bad. Instead of making a treasure, though they discarded Echo of Eons. Eesh. All right. And I guess if they Echo of Eons, it's kind of like they unmulliganed here. True Name Nemesis. Oh, no. That is bad. All right. Yeah, don't like that. Guess I'm going to have to fly over it. Sure, I'll play Soul Ring. And play Pentad Prism here for two. I'm not going to play the Hellrider because I can just leave up counter magic, as bad as that is, get hit next turn, and then Hellrider attack you back for four and kind of force them to race. Because the one thing is my deck is better at a race, though they can activate Restless Spire, which I don't really like. Oh, wow. Gitaxian Probe. I'm going to memory lapse that. I don't love the play, to be honest. And I do it in response to Dragon's Rage because this way they have to decide to surveil a decent card. So they bend it. But that's better than them looking at a new card here. Okay. Whoa, they're not attacking with Restless Spire? Okay. Maybe they're going to cast Echo of Eons. That's actually going to work out kind of nicely. So remanding the probe was really good. Because now I'll let them surveil. They might not pay too much attention to it. And then I'm going to remand this, which exiles it. I don't think I want us both getting seven new cards. I want to untap, play my Hellrider, and hope to draw something else. Yeah, like Smuggler's Copter is actually great. Oh, and Rampaging Raptor. Let's just do the Raptor then. And play Copter. And smash. They hit for the same amount, but Rampaging Raptor is a little bigger. And then, so it's more resistant to burn spells. And also, the Hellrider, I can play it next turn and crew the Copter and still get Hellrider damage in, which is nice. Let's see what they leave back. Well, they're just going for the race, but again, not doing the Restless Spire. Wow. Oh man, if I had one more mana, I could really lay the beats. I think I'd just play Hellrider though. Because that does effectively 5 damage. And then I just don't crew the Copter. I don't think there's... Well, I guess it's actually just better to crew Copter using Hellrider. There's a chance I draw something. I don't know what I could draw that's better than Metamorph, but I'm not going to be able to block with Smuggler's Copter anyway, so... So they take 2. I loot. Okay, discard an island. They go to 5. Now they're pretty much dead. I mean, obviously there's cards they could draw that could potentially get them out of it, but it's going to be pretty hard with Metamorph coming down next turn. And I'm not that close to dying. Had I gotten hit twice with Restless Spire, I'd be at 8, and then they could attack me for 6 down to 2, so they wouldn't necessarily win. They'd be a lot closer than if they didn't attack with those Restless Spires. And also, any card they flip that's an artifact or creature, they once again, you know, get the channeler up to a 3-3. That was the best memory lapse on Gitaxian Probe I've ever seen. Like, I haven't seen a counterspelling probe ever be good, but that was actually really good because then they echoed into a remand. Very funny. All right, let's get to round 2. Alrighty, time for round 2. Good news is, probably won't play against Lotus Ancestral this round. And, the great news is, they're going to have to play against Sol Ring. I'm going to go turn 1, Taiga, Sol Ring, and wish Pentad Prism was a talisman. Probably then, yeah, I definitely have to cycle Oliphant. And I think I'm just going to get Steam Vents. Is that the right land? Probably is. And then turn 2, well, we'll see what they play on turn 1. But the goal with, I guess I don't need to do that now. The goal of Seasoned Pyromancer is to cast it as your last card in hand, because that always works nicely. Oh, now we're going to get to Flame Tongue then. Oh, man, the turn 2 Flame Tongue is a delight. So I'm going to let, oops, mana go in there, pay 2 life. Flame Tongue, Kavu, your delighted halfling, and then... Next turn, we're in the potential zone of getting to cast Surge Ginger with Miscalc up. Unless they have like a Swords to Plowshares, they're in a lot of trouble here. I'm going to send for 4. And then I think I am going to get to cast this Seasoned Pyro with no cards in hand. Because I'm going to cast Surge Ginger and then cast a Pentad Prism for 2, and if I have to cast Miscalc, I'll just have to use 1 of those 2. So I think that's a gamble you're frequently going to want to take, where you play Prism for 2 with a 2-mana card in hand and 1 mana left. If they make you play the card, you're down 1 Prism counter, and if they don't, you're up 2 Prism counters. So, easy miscalculation on the Undermount Adventure. Getting the initiative is actually kind of risky for them, given the board situation, but I'm still not going to let them resolve it, especially since I kind of want to just Pyromancer here. In fact, that is exactly what I'll do. I'm going to pay the life. I feel like there's a chance that I want to spend the mana. Okay, it didn't really matter. Copter, Pyromancer, Bash for 7, they're at 9, facing down 4 attackers. This sounds pretty good. It's going to be pretty hard for a fair green-white deck to come back from that. Even if they have Wrath, next turn I'm immediately back rebuilt. I get to exile this, make 2 tokens, and then crew the Smuggler's Copter, so that's awesome. All right, Fire Covenant is going to be very good in this matchup. Don't want Hellrider. Don't think I want Thrill Seeker. I like all the counters. There is some thought to Anduril in this kind of deck. It's pretty good when you're trying to fight over the initiative. But, yeah, maybe I'll take out Sir Ginger for Anduril here. I feel like the payoff on Anduril is quite high, and Sir Ginger is not the strongest against green creatures. Like, it trades with elves. They've got the 3-4. We know about that at least. There's often like 4-4s. It just feels like a little weak. But if I see a couple planeswalkers and get a better idea of their deck, if we were to go to a game 3, which my goal is we do not, we could make that swap. Hellrider, the other, is kind of the same thing, where like if they have a 3-4 or 4-4 out, you can't even attack with the Hellrider. So tapping out for Hellrider is just not that great of a play. All right, I am on the draw, and all right, there's not that many 5 land hands I would keep with this deck, but I'm definitely going to keep this one, because if I get Smuggler's Copter Mogda going, it goes really hard, and I do Sol Ring. What an incredible draw. Sol Ring's always great. I mean, it's not even basically a piece of power. It is a piece of power. But sometimes when you draw it on turn one, you're just stunned by how good it is, because now I get to go turn two Mogda, crew Copter, get a treasure with Mogda because it became tapped, and then the Copter will let me loot away these excess lands. So I am in a spot where if they have like a Swords to Plowshares or next turn a Pest Infestation or Loran to kill the Copter, this draw is a little vulnerable. And in fact, this looks like, oh, March on Sol Ring. Okay, I actually don't mind that. I would rather they do that than kill the Copter, because I have Mogda, so I'm going to get my mana back in no time. All right, I can't leave up Memory Lapse. That was crazy talk, of course, but the Memory Lapse does mean they just have one turn before the Smuggler's Copter gets to be backed up my Memory Lapse. So they don't have a lot of time to waste here. Discard Mountain, I think. I feel like I want double blue eventually, and I pay less life by going Island and then crack Foothills for Mountain, because if I discard Island, then to get blue, I have to get a Steam Vents or a Ketria Triumph. So happy enough discarding the Mountain there. I'll keep the Wasteland, because we also like would love to get an opportunity to Wasteland them. I'm just making an extra land drop every turn with this combo. So as long as this combo is going, status quo is great for me. Basically, if I can untap with both Mogda and Copter in play, I feel like I'm probably going to win the game. If they can deal with one or both of them, then we've got a real game going. I still have plenty of mana. It's a close game. But if both get dealt with, that's bad. All right, Mox Ruby is not a great start for me. Flickerisp. Okay. Well, that's fine. So they flickered their planes and played a Waterlogged Grove and a Delighted Halfling. And they have one card left? Okay. No, this looks great. Let's take our turn. Crew the Copter. I might actually play that Oliphant. I'm going to have to... Oh, wait. No, they have Flicker with Mother of Runes. I was just blanking. Hold on. Well, Mother of Runes can't protect from Copter. I think I just attack here. Loot it. So here it's actually close. So looting is very good, but Mogda, it can't be worth it. I already have a play for this turn, which is Memory Lapse. I'm just going to play my Wasteland, kill the Waterlogged Grove while they're tapped out. Mogda plus Copter is just tap, make a treasure. I should try to preserve that. And if they attack with Flickerisp, I attack them back with Copter. So, and I'm going to Memory Lapse their next play. So no, I'm not as happy as I was a second ago. I saw them play Flickerisp and I'm like, oh, that's not Skyclave Apparition. I'm definitely Memory Lapsing the Luminarch. But the Flickerisp does mean the party is kind of over for the time being, at least in terms of attacking with Copter. Okay, they're going to send for one. And I can play Oliphant on my turn. I guess I probably will. Oh, Mother of Runes kind of dunks on that, but I might be able to maneuver a situation next turn where the Oliphant attacks. And then maybe the Mother of Runes gets tapped and I can land a Flame Tongue. We also are getting to close to the amount of treasures needed to go get Glorybringer. Because Magda actually has another ability, sack five treasures, get a dragon or an artifact. And if that were the case, then I don't know, we could start getting somewhere. So now this turn, if I attack with Oliphant and Copter, my opponent might be tempted to blocking the Oliphant and giving one of their things pro red, at which point the Flame Tongue can come down. Let's see who gets buffed here. Maybe the Flicker Wisp probably should be. Because if you buff the Flicker Wisp, then you can make that block I'm talking about. Now I'm going to offer up the Oliphant. Oh, and the Flicker Wisp. Well, I guess it would still trade for Copter. Mana Drain. All right. I'm going to crew the Copter. Now I'm going to attack. Because I think there's a pretty good chance they double block here. And then I also need to Flame Tongue that Luminarch Aspirant. If I don't, then it's going to be pretty bad for me. All right, draw, discard. Huh. Inti Sinistral of the Sun. Well, I'm definitely playing Flame Tongue this turn. Inti's pretty good, but if I want to keep Inti, I have to sack the treasure to play Flame Tongue. And my treasure machine is probably going down this turn. I think I discard Inti. All right, let's see how this turns out. Part of the reason to discard Inti there is like keeping Inti is like basically discarding Wooded Foothills and Treasure Token. I don't really want to discard both. Oh, wow. Okay. Sure. I like this block. I mean, this is how they have to take down Oliphant, and I guess it does take down their Smuggler's Copter. I might actually, apologies to Inti, I might not play Flame Tongue this turn. The only creature they're going to have that's going to survive is going to have a pro red. They didn't have any tricks. Okay. Yeah, the Copter tramples for a bunch too. I guess I play my land and pass the turn. Now I wish I had kept Inti. Huh. I guess I didn't see it going down that way. Okay, they're going to pass. I'll just pass. Steam Vents. Yes. Crack Foothills. And I can just get a mountain here. I could get Blood Crypt, I guess, but I don't think paying life is probably worth it there. All right, let's kill the Halfling, and then we get to attack and make a treasure. Now we have 6 points on the board. They're at 9. They have one card in hand, plus they're about to draw another one, and we can Mana Drain their next spell. Feels like we've gotten ourselves into a good position here, because if they miss this turn, they're dead. And if they hit this turn, I get a draw step first, too. So they do have one card in hand, plus the Svanna now, so yeah, I guess this is the card they're playing. Augur of Autumn, we're definitely going to Mana Drain that. And then I'm going to attack them down to 3, and I get a draw step first, even. If I draw anything, they're very clearly dead. Boom. Yep, Char will do it. Add the mana. Char you, and Magda really did some work this game. I'll say that. Magda made a lot of treasures. The Magda Smuggler's Copter combo is a good one. All right, let's get to round 3. This deck's been playing out pretty nicely. Alrighty, after taking a break since those are some intense couple matches, we're back for round 3. I would like to be on the play, and yeah, I mean, I guess I keep this hand. It's not great, but against a creature deck, I can Fork Bolt their first play, Memory Lapse the second play, and then maybe that gets me to Flame Tongue. The biggest risk here is against a non-creature deck where this hand doesn't do that much. Like if I knew I was playing against combo, I guess I'd probably mulligan. But enough decks in Cube are creature-based, then I think this is a totally keepable hand. Island goes. Not what I wanted to see. All right, well, Bone Crusher is a decent draw, because now, if they don't do anything, I'm just going to Bone Crusher at them. and then untap and cast the Bone Crusher. What I really want is them to play a small creature this turn, though. That's almost impossible now that they've played their second island. Though not impossible. Whoa. Okay. Don't like Helm of Awakening. We kept a hand that's bad against combo, and we are playing against combo. So now... And... The upside is now I get to cast Bone Crusher and still have Memory Lapse or Miscalculation up, thanks to the Helm. I could see this working out. Like, look at this world. They cast a spell this turn, and let's say I cast one of these two counters. If I draw any red source, because of the Helm, I can play Goldspan Dragon, attack for 8, and have the other counter up. That probably wins me the game. So I actually kind of feel like we're doing all right here, if we draw red. If we don't draw red, it's a little bit closer. But I would prefer them go for a sorcery speed play this turn. Palantir. That, I think, is okay. I just don't think it's worth countering Palantir. I could be wrong here, but I don't have to let them draw a card here. And having these two counters up for their next two plays seems better. I'm not letting them draw a card. I take one off Ponder. That's fine. So Island's not ideal. And they haven't played a land I can wasteland. So I just get to hit for 4. But because their play last turn wasn't one I felt I had to counter, it's kind of like we bought ourselves an extra turn where I can maybe counter this turn and then still make the Goldspan play. We're also getting to the point where, like, if I hit him for 4 counter, hit him for 4 counter, that they're pretty low. So that puts me, gives them one turn of doing something. I don't like them starting with Gitaxian Probe, though. Miscalculation in particular is fairly easy to play around. It's a little harder to play around Memory Lapse, though. So I think basically it makes the value of Memory Lapse pretty close to what it was. The fact that they know about it, it's not that big of a deal. It makes the value of Miscalculation a lot lower, because now they can kind of sequence their plays such that Miscalculation doesn't really get them, especially with Helm out. Helm does make Miscalculation a lot worse because it just means they have more mana at their disposal. But we'll see. All right, no plays. I'm not going to cycle Miscalc, though. Nor am I going to let them draw a card. So let's go ahead and say no. Black Lotus and Mystical Tutor? Are you kidding me? Oof, their deck is great. Ooh, Mana Drain is actually not a bad draw, because now I've got a third counter, which it kind of swings. I keep thinking, you know, where the pivotal turn going to be? The fact that they made no play last turn and I drew Mana Drain puts it pretty firmly in my favor. And even if Miscalculation doesn't take a whole turn of theirs, Mana Drain almost assuredly will be. Turnabout targeting me. Oh, that's not that bad, because now I can use the Miscalculation. And I can pay for that. And then next turn, I can Memory Lapse. Then they go to 4, I attack them, and then maybe I Mana Drain the turn after. All right. Well, it turns out even with Probe, the Miscalculation had plenty of value. All right, I'm going to have to Memory Lapse this. Yeah. Definitely don't want to let that resolve. And now they have Palantir. And I'm at 18. No, I'm not going to have them draw a card. All right. I milled Memory Jar and Yawgmoth's Will. Nice. I'm really glad I just took the damage. I was opening myself up to die if they hit like an Emrakul, but I didn't feel like I should let them draw, and I'm glad I didn't. All right, well, very close to winning here, too. A red source would have done it, but I kind of feel like Mana Drain's going to be enough to win me this game, though their deck looks sick, so I'm glad we might steal a game here, because I think this is going to be a tough match, and we haven't even necessarily won this game. We probably have, but I don't know if they have, like, Time Twister with a counterspell backup, or maybe a Duress or something, and then a good spell. That's not seeming super likely with just 3 cards in hand, but it is possible. Oh, no play. Okay, well, now I'm definitely going to let them draw a card. 10 I could die from if they had like an Echo of Eons. Yes, you can draw a card. Like Time Spiral or Echo of Eons almost kills me, plus 3 more cards. All right, Mountain, and I don't really feel like playing another creature is good here. Because I'd rather just have Mana Drain up, is kind of my thought. Though maybe Goldspan is actually worth playing. No, now that I think about it, Goldspan would have been worth playing because, I mean, I guess it's better that I didn't because I don't know about it. But Goldspan probably gets me the treasure to cast mana under most circumstances. All right, well, here I definitely want a Hellrider. I don't want Fire Covenant, so I can take out the Blood Crypt. It doesn't really do anything for me. Put in a Mountain. And I think I want Thrill Seeker as well, probably over Fury. Fury doesn't look like it does anything. The one thing Fury could do is kill a Planeswalker, but I don't think there's anything else in here. Flame Tongue actually also kind of wants to go. Maybe I just put an Anduril because it's a lot of damage and I kind of assume they don't have a lot of removal. All right, up a game here. And to be honest, this is the kind of deck that Blue-Red Tempo is good against. A couple key counters can really knock over Storm, but they have what looks like a very good Storm deck. Yogwill Lotus is already enough to be pretty impressive. So I'm going to keep this hand, but I can just easily see myself losing very quickly to their deck. Like, they even have good cantrips. It just seems like it's going to be tough. So we'll see how it goes. I mean, Lotus Yogwill is a lot, but a well-timed Memory Lapse could be decent. So here I'm going to play Sir Ginger on turn 2. Probably just play Bone Crusher on 3. Wow. Okay, they didn't have the double cantrip opener. They did have a Mox Diamond, which generally, if you're not going to use the mana against a red deck, you shouldn't play it. Because what if I had like turn on Embereth Shieldbreaker? But in any case, there's Helm. Okay. I think I'm going to cast Sir Ginger and leave up Memory Lapse here. With Helm out, I can pretty much leave up Memory Lapse every turn without costing me too much. So, like here, instead of playing... Oh, they're going to Brazen Borrower, sure. Oh, that makes sense as a play, but I'm not that worried about Brazen Borrower. Mystic Forge, yeah, that I'm going to Memory Lapse. It's only going to buy me a turn, but... Mystic Forge isn't just game over. Their deck didn't even look like that great of a Mystic Forge deck. Oh, unfortunately... Can't get untapped blue with this, so yeah, I guess I'm gonna have to deal with Mystic Forge. And I think I want to play. I think I'm just gonna play. No. Yeah, I'm just gonna play both my creatures. I think that's probably. I just need to get creatures into play, and then next turn, they're gonna play Mystic Forge. Hopefully, they don't play anything else. They didn't have that many artifacts. But it still is good card selection because you can tap it to exile the top card. Where it gets awkward if your top card's good, like it seems like theirs is, then the Mystic Forge didn't do too much. Oh, Inti is actually great. So let's play Inti. Attack here for 7. And I'm going to discard probably Metamorph here. Well, I could just discard Asika's Chariot. I don't think I'm going to need that one. Though I suppose if I don't draw anything to play off Inti that I want to play this turn, it's tricky because then I'll play a Seeker's Chariot for my play for the turn. So I guess Metamorph is still a fine backup play. No, there's actually nothing good to Metamorph. All right, I'll just discard the Metamorph then. And I think I put the counter on Sir Ginger just to spread out my things. I don't think I need the stats too much. And I exiled a Hellrider. Well, okay, I guess I'll play Hellrider then. Okay, so let's go land, crack this, and yeah, can't get a second blue, but I think we're just going to try to end the game before that happens. Just hope they don't go off next turn. Because now I have Hellrider, I definitely have Lethal in play, and they have a turn with Mystic Forge, and they like their top card. So it's not Black Lotus, because they would have played that one off Mystic Forge, but it is something they do like. And now they exiled Xander's Lounge. Oh, they didn't. Okay. If I draw a blue, the game's just over. I think I'm going to seek the beast here because I don't think they're going to respond. All right. And I hit the blue. That's exactly what I was looking for. And now if they go to Turnabout me, I can mana drain it. Turnabout is actually the kind of card they would have kept. They really should have done it in response to seek the beast here. Because otherwise, yeah. Oh, Cryptic Command, even better. Mana Drain, and boom, that is a trophy. We get to bash for 5, 10, 14, 18 damage this turn, and That'll do it. All right. Well, take a look at this deck before we sign off here. This was a solid aggro control deck. It was classic blue reds. Had Mana Drain, Remand, Miscalc, and Memory Lapse as the only blue cards, because Metamorph's not even blue. So just straight up 4 2 mana counters. With a very critical Steam Vents alongside Wooded Foothills and Polluted Delta and Khetria Triome to actually have playable mana, even splashed Fire Covenant, though that didn't really move the needle much one way or the other. Same with Chariot. The Questing Druid was pretty good. So some decent splashes, one busted card in Sol Ring, and a bunch of just solid cards. It overall worked pretty well. You know, we got our Fury, Glorybringer, Goldspan, and was happy with the results. So thank you for watching. As always, thanks to Ultimate Guard for being the sponsor of Team CFB, and of course to TCG Player for all your card needs. All right, I'll catch you next time.